I've had a lot of trouble in the past few days trying to make episodes for this series. I keep running into a problem where the game goes and plays and playing through fine, and I plug in all that, and I get to the end and realize none of my feeling generation is the plane. It drives me freaking insane. Two episodes now this has happened. Now, in the previous episode, I just uploaded the file without the narration and said, oh well, because let them talk. Lost a save file. I lost a save file, and didn't want to record the episode, go through all the effort of doing it. Now, in this case, I also lost a save file, so I'm like, oh, crap. You know what? Just put the video in Premiere and record the audio commentary the old school way that I used to do with just playing the gameplay first and then recording the audio narration after that. So that's what I'm doing now. Now, I gotta go and I got to locate all of the areas where these plates have described where they go, these various temples. And it occurred to me while I was doing this that I had not yet explored the airship, or at least didn't do it on the video. So I do a quick run through. Most of the characters are still here. Obviously, Dagger and Nico aren't here anymore because they left on their own little mission. And, you know, I'm a little underwhelmed with the way this airships out. Now, it was kind of late in the game to get this airship, and maybe a bit of a spoiler, but we're not going to hold on to it for all that long, so I guess the developers didn't really feel a need to create it as an environment that you're going to be running around in. Normally, in these kinds of things, you create the airship or the environment that the characters sort of default to, and you want it to have a little bit of a better layout, because you're going to run around and talk to all the characters every once in a while and there's a plot progression. So you get there's a little more character interaction there. And this, I mean, the environment's pretty cool, but it's not really laid out. It's just a long tunnel to get onto. This character's here. So it's sort of like a more hub-like kind of platform for you to go to. Now we gotta go and find our next, anyway, the airship is all right, I guess, but it could have been better, but it's not that big of a deal. I also kind of like the design. Now, I don't like the darker colors, even though that does kind of fit with the art style and aesthetic of this game here. Sort of darker, more industrial in a way. But I do sort of like the polygonal kind of model of it. I also like the articulation of the wings down at the bottom, as well as the propellers flipping around on the top there, on the back. The Highwind 7 didn't quite have that kind of look to it. Even though I think it did have props, and then they fell off and it had sort of like a jet or a rocket engine. The Ragnarok, I really didn't care for that because it was more or less just all the time. Didn't have it very long. The Ragnarok even had a worse layout than this airship does. So, thankfully, that's over. Now we gotta go find our next location. I think I maybe didn't know what I was doing here. Oh, yes. Notice that even though the fog is gone, now that we're flying around a lot, you kind of get the mist is gone. The fog in the game world is still there. although it's pushed out further, so you do see a little bit of pop-up. It really only becomes obvious when you fly in an area with mountains and all that kind of stuff. You zip into an area with mountains, as you come across that mountain, you see the different faces of the model sort of appearing in the environment. Now, it's not a mountain, it just sort of creeps across the ground, and the mist that's off in the distance sort of obscures it. But overall, I think it's probably the best overworld technology-wise that we've seen in a PlayStation Final Fantasy. It would have been nice to see what they could have done with a PlayStation 2 Final Fantasy game built in this style with an overworld to fly around in. But you didn't see it because 10 and 12. Single-player games in that series for PS2 didn't feature a traditional open world or overworld. It was just sort of you move from one environment to the next, and when you finally do get an airship in either of those two games, you more or less just choose an option on the map and you just load into that environment. Hell, 13 had a similar setup, which was a PS3 and 360 game. 15, jumping into the next generation after that. I don't know, it doesn't have an overworld at all. And you just large environment that you have. It's seamless, and it does, you have an airship in a sense, and you can fly around. But that's what, three generations removed from this. So I just wish I could have seen what they did. Has to stand behind him. Alright, we're stuck with Quinna, whatever Quinnet is supposed to be. Unfortunately, I ran into a problem where I guess like a lot of players would have done. We ignored Quinna as a character. Don't choose Quinna, you don't have to choose Quinna. Quinna doesn't get a couple ups, Quinna doesn't get the blue magic, Quinna doesn't get the abilities. So, Quinna was level 32 or something. So you're going to see me when I go to this dungeon that we're going out here, and it's really not a long dungeon. But Quinna is severely under-geared for this fight. I'm looking for the Desert Palace. I couldn't remember what the hell that was supposed to be. That was where Pooja had kept him hostage a few episodes back. There it is. Autopilot. That was one of the things that I really enjoyed about this game in its first half. Or let's call it the first half of the match. It was so plot-driven that, on one hand, it did make you feel kind of constrained when you were doing it. But on the other hand, it sort of constantly presented a reason why you're in a place and a justification for it all that. It also forced you to use all of your characters. In this place, it's only Steiner and Dagger, like Marcus or somebody was there. So you're like, okay, now we're Steiner and Dagger, they're getting their time. Steiner's not, like, there's not a lot of fights, there's not a lot of stuff for them, but we are playing as the characters that you move over. Dagger and Vivi are in this place, and it's just splits everybody up and lets each character have a time to shine, so everybody sort of participates. Now, after a certain point, the game sort of breaks it up like the other games in the series tend to do, and you choose your player, you choose your characters, and when that happens, certain characters I didn't like. Like Amaranth or insert the name of the character you didn't like here, they got ignored. And I didn't want to play as them, so I didn't play as them. I'm driving around in circles of academics. Here was such a problem. Quina didn't play as Quina, didn't want to play as Quina. Quina, low level. Level 30 or something like that. Going into a dungeon here, let's see what happens. Now this is where we're going to spill some money. And we have our fight. It's our boss battle, and it's the only fight we're actually going to have in this dungeon. And it kind of messes me up a little bit. Well, like, as you can see, Quina, low health, low damage output, all that kind of stuff, it's not going to be an easy fight. Also, note that the... I like the design of this boss, at least. I guess since they weren't going to put so much effort into creating a long dungeon and new enemies and all that kind of stuff to go and have you fight, we are just going to focus all of our effort into creating a few different really cool looking bosses. And each one, Steiner, Levy, and the other characters had encountered all looked pretty cool, and I think this is probably the best looking design of that group. And so it's an awesome looking boss, an awesome display of the technical proficiency these guys had for the PlayStation 1, with like some cool looking textures and geometry and all that kind of stuff. Unfortunately, I wish the there was a better kind of dungeon to go along with it. The game looks like it's playing slow here, and it probably is. I had to screw around with the files a little bit to get the mirror to accept it. The Bandicam that I'm using, the presets I tend to use don't import very well into Adobe Premiere. They tend to get all pixelated, so I had to convert the file to a format and import it here, maybe it didn't work out. But I can still see what I'm looking at, so I'm gonna accept that. The design of that guy, that's awesome. Got the cave and everything. Now, Zidane, I'd say, Zidane is powerful enough to be able to fight this thing. Quinna, no. Quinna's getting faster. Man, I don't know. Now, these are the Guardians of Terra. Now, we have seen a point where we know that Terra is another world, and perhaps this is some sort of guard, these are Guardians to the Gateway, or something like that. But we're not on Terra, we're on Gaia. What the hell are the Guardians doing here? And this one makes note that it's not working for Kuja, it is working for Terra, it's working for the best interests of Terra. And whether that lines up, ooh, Avengers, that's awesome. And whether that lines up with Kuja's plans or not, I guess it really doesn't matter. Now we're getting to the point where Zidane is, well, Zidane, I'm still trying to steal for some stupid ass reason while this thing's kicking my ass. I guess I figured Zidane was powerful enough to be able to just brute force his way through this fight. But the problem is, I don't actually have the healing stuff items that really restore his health. Quinna, I mean, I guess maybe there was that blue magic that I could have had or something, other than White Wind, that would have helped here. But I didn't have it, so. Fight doesn't really go that well. Now I'm trying to go and resurrect Quinna, and geez, that looks powerful, doesn't it? And it was. Zidane's dead. So I came back and I grinded, and then I won that fight, and somehow managed to skip over it in the recording, and here we are.